Well, I finally got the computer to work, and I know that's a small thing compared to the people back east who are trying to get their lives to work, back to work. So, everybody hang in there and just continue to practice your good habits. You know, don't let your life get completely off the tracks. Stay with your good habits. Now, what we're doing here is we're offering reassurance, and what we're doing, we're clarifying what our true identity really is, which is what we call Christ, Buddha, nature, whatever you want to call it. And we're drawing distinction between truth and belief, which is the all-important distinction. Truth is inflexible because it is true. It's always true. Reality is always real. It cannot change. So you would say it's perfectly inflexible. But the term inflexible doesn't even apply because, since it cannot change at all, what's the use of saying it's inflexible? Inflexible implies that it can change but refuses to. But for the sake of language, we will say it's inflexible. Belief is also inflexible, completely inflexible, because belief believes that reality can change. That's what belief is. The desire for reality to be changed gives rise to belief. So that's what belief is. And belief is entirely inflexible. It can never say, well, I don't desire for a reality to be changed. It can never truly accept that. It cannot. So you have two inflexibilities. You have belief and reality. Okay, belief and truth. And you simply have to choose which one you want to experience. That's it. Sum total of the entire situation is you just have a choice to make between two perfectly inflexible situations. What complicates the issue is that belief, knowing that that is the choice, tries to present itself as flexible, okay, and says there's a third option. That is where the trouble resides, is this assertion by belief. There's a third option. What's the third option? A immutable mutableness. A truthful lie. You know, a hybrid between truth and belief. And belief says it's working on that, and that's it'll manage to do this. That's a lie. Okay. And belief is inflexible in presenting its lies. It continually lies. It just dresses them up in different clothing. But all that belief does is a lie. You cannot have that which is immutable and at the same time be mutable. It's impossible. It's either one or the other. If you think about it, consider this very carefully, you begin to see that belief's option of saying there's a third option, this flexibility, integration between the two, between two completely inflexible situations. That is what supposedly our goal as human, you know, the goal of human beings is to bring about this flexibility. It's not possible. It's impossible. And there again, belief is entirely inflexible in believing that it can change reality. To bring about a third option, some kind of integration between truth and lies, is the belief you can change reality. And I've said belief is the belief that it can change, that reality can be changed. So how is it any different for belief to say, well, we're going to make a hybrid, we're going to integrate truth and belief? That's still the belief that reality can be changed. Exactly the same. It just presents it in an attractive packaging. So again, belief always believes that reality can be changed, and it keeps presenting to us these options like, you know, hey, this is really great. This is very spiritual. This is what you need. Let's integrate the two. Let's get some integral truth, which is part truth and part not truth. That is, again, the belief that truth can be changed, because truth is entirely inflexible and says only truth is true. It is immutable. It is unchangeable. It is eternal. It is never ending. It is invulnerable, can never be threatened. All of those aspects, qualities. It's all inclusive. It's all just one identity, which is everything, every aspect of reality, all of reality shares and belongs to all of reality. Okay, so everything has everything. That is reality. There's no such thing as some aspect of reality doesn't have everything. Everything has everything in reality, and that is the one identity. All in all, everything having everything. There's only one identity, one shared identity in reality. That's it. And that is this infinite richness, that everything in reality has everything. Totally all-inclusive, one shared identity in reality. That is it. There's not all sorts of separate identities that communicate. No, there's just one shared identity, and that is this, the implicit, inherent knowing that everything in reality belongs to everyone. You have access, you have full experiential access to all of reality. Everything does. So there's no difference in the richness in reality. And belief believes that reality can be changed. All these attributes of reality can be changed. In fact, it insists that they will be changed. They were going to be changed. It never can never deviate from that, because belief is just an effect of an idea. And belief constantly is threatened that we're going to change, choose a new idea. So it constantly pretends, tells us that it's changed. It's changed what it is. That it's not asking us to try to change reality. It's asking us to integrate the mutable and the immutable, the all-inclusive and exclusiveness, the one identity and many identities. It's going to integrate those. How can you integrate one shared identity with many identities? Two are completely exclusive. Truth and lies are actually completely exclusive, mutually exclusive. One denies the other. So belief is asking us, stating that it believes reality can be changed. It would have to. For any of the offers that belief keeps giving us, reality would have to be changed, which means that's what belief believes, that reality can be changed. No difference. And yet we keep thinking there's some third option. No. That so-called third option is simply the inflexibility of belief, which is just, you know, either that or the inflexibility of belief. It's either that or the inflexibility of truth. Neither one can change. They're entirely inflexible. And we simply have to choose which one we want. That's it. When we begin to see that the choice as it is, then it becomes easier to make the choice. But as long as we think there's some third option, we're going to be pursuing that third option, thinking that, aha, we have a better idea. Like, oh, you know, let's be flexible. What does that mean, flexibility? Meaning that truth is true now, but in the next moment it's not true? How is that possible? Or that there's one shared identity, just one shared identity, and there's also many shared identities? How is that possible? There's the truth is immutable, and truth is also immutable. And the truth is immutable and also mutable, changeable. How is that? What is that? Is that insanity? It's insanity. That reality is everlasting, but it's also there's an end to it. Is that what we're trying to get at? You know, integration between the two. never ending endlessness. That there's endlessness and also an end to endlessness, and those two are integrated. The endlessness and an end to endlessness are somehow integratable. That's what belief is telling us, and that's what we're pursuing. And when you see the complete madness of this, you know, you say, wow, that's completely insane. And then you start realizing, well, belief is really offering us nothing at all except total inflexibility. It's offering us insanity, really, is what it's doing. Because if we saw that it's inflexible, belief, and it's believing an impossible goal, then we'd say, I don't want that. Instead, belief offers us this so-called deal, which is completely insane. It's offering us nothing. It has no deal to offer, actually. Now, I'm saying these things standing up to belief because most of you, as of yet, aren't able to do that. Because I've already been through the worst, the wars with belief, and been threatened to the ultimate extent. And I've been through that, and so I'm not scared of it anymore. Not so scared of belief. Because belief is the ultimate bully. Ultimate bully. So right now I'm standing up to belief so you can see that it's possible and you can hear what it's like to stand up to belief and you can get some courage in your own recognition that you have the clarity within you to stand up to belief. It requires clarity. Standing up to belief requires clarity. It's not courage. It's not the kind of courage you get from like caffeine. See, that's why I say be careful about drinking coffee. Really be careful about it. Or any drug or anything like that, because that gives you false courage. It gives you like bluster, you know. And belief actually sponsors all this stuff. Bluster. Give you a false sense of courage, of capability to stand up to belief. And belief says, oh boy, I better back away now. You've got all this energy and bluster. And it loves that. But it doesn't like you to be very calm and very sober and look at things very carefully. Then it starts getting very shaky and worried and concerned, because you're developing the clarity to stand up to belief, that bully. And you're able to say, wait a minute, bully, you know, you're offering me insanity is what you're doing, which is nothing. You're pretending to be flexible when the fact of the matter is you're completely inflexible. You're still insisting that reality can be changed. By offering a hybrid of reality and illusion, that is exactly offering that the belief that reality can be changed. How could it not be? You know, it's completely obvious. So it is this clarity that enables one to stand up to belief and start to divest it of its ability to terrorize us, really, because belief is just absolutely a ferocious, extremely frightening bully. When you play its game and believe in what it's telling you, it seems like a benevolent deity, you know. And when you question what it's offering you and you say, no, wait a minute, you know, this isn't working for me and I need to see why, it becomes an extremely wrathful deity. And I use the term deity as a figure of speech. It's not a deity at all, but it pretends to be. If you allow it to bully you, it will insist that it's God, actually. And most people that worship God are actually worshiping belief, because they're extremely intimidated by belief. And they're terrified to not worship it as a deity. That doesn't mean that those who don't worship it as God are free of belief at all, no. Because it also offers other alternatives to seeing it as a deity. As seeing it, that there's nothing there. See, if there's nothing there, how can belief be threatened? You know, all this just came out of nothing, mysterious, nobody knows why, etc., etc. Then, you know, belief is hiding, then hides and says, and doesn't seem feel like a target, you know, that you can track it down and say, hey, you know, this is all comes from belief. This is just a belief system, all this. So, you know, one or the other, either it gets you to worship it as a deity or gets you to accept the atheistic position. There is no, you know, no nothing there at all in existence. It's just all a random chance kind of thing that just evolves out of nothing, which is nonsense. It hides itself that way. So, you know, just hearing this stuff, you know, even if you can't put all the dots together, you know, and assemble the mosaic, at least you get this feeling like there's someone here in the world who's able to stand up to belief and say the stuff that, you know, you would be like, whoa, I better not say that. Belief's really going to never forgive me if I say that kind of stuff. Of course it'll never forgive you. Belief cannot forgive truth. It hates truth. It denies truth. See, belief, what belief engages us in is to try to straighten out belief. Belief says, somehow I'm all messed up. You got to straighten me out. Once you straighten belief out, everything will be fine. No, belief is like a tar baby. It sticks to itself continuously. Belief believes in a belief. You can never straighten it out. It's never, you know, no matter how you try to straighten it out, it goes back, you know, like that. It keeps devouring itself. It cannot ever be straightened out. It simply keeps on with the way that it is. But what we can do is we can drop belief altogether. Don't try to straighten it out. Trying to straighten belief out is the false path that wastes your time. The true path is to simply exchange belief for, you know, truth. Exchange the idea of wanting to be prime creator, which gives rise to desire, which gives rise to belief. Change that for the idea of not trying to be prime creator, but accept spirit accepting itself as it is, as an effect of prime creator, as an extension of prime creator. And then there is no belief arises from that at all. What arises is knowing, which isness, which is unconditional love. That's what arises. There's no future. It's right now. Now extends endlessly. Knowingness, which is right now, extends endlessly. Knowing extends endlessly. There's no gap. There's no, you know, don't need a future. If you know right now, what do you need a future for to figure something out? You know, already know your identity now. So you don't need a gap, a future where you would feel like you don't know now, but you're going to know in the sometime in the future and have a desire to know. Now, if you know right now, you don't have a desire to know. You already know. So don't try to straighten belief out. You can never do it. It's completely insane. It's completely inflexible. How can you straighten out what's completely inflexible? You don't need to straighten belief out. You just need to set it down. Because belief is, it's completely adhered to itself. It's self-adhered completely. Inherently, it's impossible to straighten belief out. And yet belief engages us in that activity, ceaselessly trying to figure out what's wrong with belief, how do we straighten it out, etc., etc. The key insight is to see you cannot straighten it out. It's inflexible. It's trying to fulfill a desire that can never be fulfilled. It's on an impossible quest. It's on a futile quest. And it continually hides this by trying to claim there's some path of integration where you straighten out belief and you straighten out truth and you fit them together somehow and all of this stuff. It's always trying to establish these relationships to help straighten each other out, you know, and solve relationship problems, etc., etc. No, that's not the way. Set down belief. Exchange it for unconditional love, for the overlay, the perfect overlay of all belief. That which is not trying to change anything, which accepts everything exactly as it is, which accepts belief exactly as it is, which is nothing, which is futility. Okay? It doesn't try to change belief. It doesn't try to straighten belief out. It overlays it. Total difference between trying to straighten something out and overlaying it. Okay? Completely different. So what belief is asking us to do is continue to engage in futility, to straighten out belief, to integrate truth and lies, to accomplish the impossible, to accept insanity as something of value, as a goal can be reached. And what truth tells you to do is choose a new idea and overlay belief. Don't try to change belief at all. Just see that which overlays it and is not trying to change it. Can't change belief. Can't change what it is. So unconditional love knows this and just overlays it. Doesn't try to straighten it out. When we gave mind an impossible task to make us prime creator, all mind can do is generate all this insanity and tell us that's possible, it's possible, which is insane. Trying to present the impossible as possible is, by definition, has to be insanity, right? Has to be. That's all a belief is. It's simply insanity. It's saying that you can have unchangeable immutableness and also changeable mutableness at simultaneously. Which is completely nuts. Or you can have endlessness and an end to endlessness simultaneously. Both can be true. No, It's not possible. That's insanity, complete insanity. It's all it is. And the more we see this, to say, oh, there's nothing there, there's nothing of value there, belief has nothing to give us, there is no such thing as integration, belief is completely inflexible, and truth is also completely inflexible. Truth cannot be changed, and neither can belief. Belief can't be changed. Its purpose can't be changed, but we can choose a new idea. Once you choose an idea, the effects of that idea cannot be changed. Cannot. But we're completely free to choose a new idea, and then that new idea will have its effects, which also cannot be changed. So cause and effects are immutably one. Cause and effect. There's no separation between cause and effect. There's no gap. And this is the standing up to belief, because belief won't tell you any of this stuff. If you wonder how come you haven't heard this before, it's because belief won't tell it to you. It'll tell you a ton of other stuff, all sorts of stuff, all sorts of spirituality, all sorts of paths, but it'll never get down to the nitty-gritty and tell you what's really the situation. And the reason why there's so much of that teaching in the world is because we're afraid. So many people are afraid, are intimidated by belief. As I've said, belief is the very definition of intimidation. And I went through that, and I don't, it's too bad that we have to go through that and stand up to belief and receive this blow, you know, how it tries to intimidate us, and it's a terrible thing, very frightening. But, had to work through all that fear, that the threats that belief brought up to, you know, try and force me to back away from the nitty-gritty truth and try to divert me into something else that didn't threaten belief so badly. Some compromise between truth and belief. There's no compromise. How can there be a compromise between two inflexibilities? Cannot be. And we've shown that belief isn't totally inflexible. And truth, too, is totally inflexible. Truth cannot be changed, therefore it's inflexible. Belief cannot change truth, yet the purpose of it is to change truth, change reality. And so it's completely inflexible with that purpose. Cannot change its purpose. Effects cannot change the purpose that they serve. No, nothing can happen. No change can happen at the level of effects as far as purpose goes. Only at the level of ideas, which is where spirit, that's where it lives. The level of ideas, being able to choose, you know, experiencing. So at that level, the causation can be changed. The different, well, you want a different experience, you change the causation. That's where the only place that change can occur. That's how reality functions. So you're not changing reality. You're not changing how reality functions. That's impossible. You're simply accepting reality functions and then using that functionality to get the experience you want. So there's a vast ocean of teachings in this world and other worlds in the universe, and most of it is the teachings of belief. It's compromise teachings, because the fear is so great that if you get down and teach the absolute nitty-gritty truth of the situation, of course belief is going to threaten you. Absolutely, you're going to feel the wrath, full wrath of belief that tries, completely projects its own insanity onto you and claims that you're the one who's completely insane, irrevocably insane, and you're the one who's intractable, and you're the one who's worthless, and it just is extremely wrathful. And I think in certain traditions, like Buddhist traditions, you have meditations where you have to face these wrathful deities. You know, that this kind of is a way of symbolizing the wrath of belief, and how belief will try to undermine your resolve by just totally denying what you are. Severe denial, wrathful denial, that you have any capability to choose a new idea, that you're incompetent, completely incompetent. I mean, that's what belief comes at you like that, it believes you're completely incompetent to choose a new idea. It truly, it believes that, 100% believes that, and it projects that belief on you and insists that you are completely incompetent. You know, if you break it down, you're insane, you're worthless, you're stupid, you know, all this stuff. What does it mean? It means you're completely incompetent. You're incapable of choosing a new idea. Therefore, you must always choose, stay with belief. You can't leave belief, in other words. It insists it, and it tries to convince you this is so. And it is intensely ferocious in trying to convince you this is so. And if you don't accept that it is so, it, you know, it just is furious with you and believes you're just some kind of, you know, stubborn, evil, stubborn, intractable, you know, something severely wrong with you. So that's, it's bluffing, of course. It's the one that's terrified. It's the one that knows it's incompetent because it can't change what it is. And it's frustrated at this and projects that onto you. It cannot change, affecting what the purpose they serve. And so it feels like, wow, you know, you're the one who's really in charge and doesn't want you to know that. Doesn't want you to know that. And so it goes after you. And it's really, really, really difficult. That's why there are spiritual traditions that help spirit build up its clarity, build up the clarity to the point where it can then withstand this wrathful projection of incompetence upon you and reject it. Reject it. It's actually this belief that's incompetent, incapable of choosing a new idea. As belief cannot choose a new idea, it's not at the level of causation. Not at all. It's the level of effect. So it is not so common that anybody can get through this intimidation. And for me, it was absolutely terrible. There's no joke, no, you know, I cannot sugarcoat it at all. It was full on intensity that was over the top, off the charts intensity of struggle against this intimidation. And you know, I wouldn't suggest anybody go through that, which is why I highly recommend that you know, that there needs to be a true spiritual culture that help people from cradle to grave gain clarity, so that they can more easily reject the accusation of belief that will be hurled towards them. You know, Jesus just said, "Get behind me, Satan! Get behind me, belief!" You know, belief tried to, you know, tempt and threaten Jesus, and he just said, "You know, get behind me!" You know, just dismissed it like that. You know, and we can all do that. Absolutely, we can all do that. And we all have to, because belief has nothing that we want, nothing that we value. It has nothing at all for us, just insanity, and we don't really want that. So, but we can only choose a new idea and thereby set belief down when we are able to withstand this, you know, ferocious adversarial denial of our competency. And that requires clarity. Requires tremendous clarity. So if there's not a culture of clarity, if the business of a culture isn't clarity, then it's going to end up just spinning out all sorts of faux spirituality, which is a compromised teachings, which is based on a feeling of intimidation from belief. It will not get down to the truth and the nitty-gritty of it. It will not. And that's what we have today. There's never been a time when there's been so much spirituality in the world, but it's all compromised stuff, you know. It's not the real, what you really need to focus on. Simply because there has, you know, we dropped the ball, you know. Belief really asserts itself during these times, and you know, it belief took a severe blow whenever there's someone in the world who stands up to belief, like someone like Jesus, who effortlessly and completely stood up to belief 100%. That really threatens belief. It's a severe blow to belief, And belief has been trying to recover from that for a couple thousand years. And before that, there was other, you know, Buddha. And then recently there's been other teachers like Ramana Maharshi and Anandamayi Ma who completely stood up to belief. And that causes us belief, you know, tries to marshal all its intimidation and brings in those who are extremely intimidated by belief and who are experts at compromise teachings, and it brings those up and say, here you go, as a kind of a deal. So let's make a deal. You know, it gets scared and it gets into all this deal making of spiritual faux spirituality, and we're inundated with that now, which is a tough situation. There's no question about it, but it's something we have to. It's an opportunity also to recognize this. What's going on? You know, when you get great teachers in the world, it scares the heck out of belief. And belief is frantically offers up compromise situations, perspectives, to try and, you know, make a deal with this, to try and save its neck, as it were. And so you did have the great teachers in the 20th century, some strong ones in the 19th century, and you know, some ultra-incredible teachers in the 20th century. And that badly shook belief, badly. And so it started offering up a vast cornucopia of compromise deals, situations, perspectives. A vast cornucopia. Whatever, you know, everything it had. Shot all its ammunition all at once, you know. It just shot all the confetti in the air and said, here you go. Here's all the stuff. So it's been a very difficult time for those who want to reach truth because we've had to wade through all that stuff. It's taken me a long time to get through all these compromises and recognize this is all compromise teachings, you know. And it's super hard to establish a culture of clarity at this time because the world is saturated with all these compromise offerings from belief. And everybody's kind of, you know, it's kind of like junk mail, you know. If you get on enough lists, your mailbox will be stuffed every day with junk mail. And bogus scam schemes. I mean, it's unbelievable. There are those who get like three or four elaborately clever scams in the mail every day, almost every day, with unbelievably tricky, you know, stuff that just seems like it's too good to be true, and it seems all true. And then you have to be very sharp to find the catch, you know, in it all, and realize this is just all they're trying to do is scam you. And you know, we're under assault by all these marketers, direct marketing, the phone callers, the junk mailers, all these people who are saying you have won, you know, $100 million, and all you have to do is send this in to get you certified, and blah 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 blah. You know, what's in spirituality is the same way. Belief constantly is offering us all these pseudo solutions to the situation. So you've won. You can be enlightened like this. You know, here's how you can be enlightened. And it's offering all these different enlightenments. And all you have to do is you have to accept compromise, you know, with belief. And, you know, you end up just wasting your time is what happens. You get nothing. And so it's a very difficult time right now. It has been in the world because belief is really desperate, and when it's desperate, it has to bring to light all its scams, all its schemes. But the upside is, those of us who have persevered during these times have been able to see everything that belief has to offer. You know, it brought in all this high technology, all this multimedia, gee whiz stuff. You know. And we've worked through all of that and realized, is that all there is? Is it really? This is, you know, this is it? Are you kidding me? And we're supposed to accept this? It's like the merchants who came to, you know, Long Island and New York, and the Indians there, they said, hey, you know, we got this treasure chest, and they opened it up, and there's all these Venetian beads in there, you know, glass, Venetian glass. And, you know, they said, and the Indians never seen anything like that before. You know, I said, what in the world is this? And the trader said, this has incredible value. You know, it cost us an absolute fortune to get this. The Indians didn't know. They said, wow, you know, amazing. And the merchant said, I'll tell you what, you have all this land here, you know, that it's not, you know, any value to you. Let's share this land. We want to use this land too, and in exchange we'll give you these incredibly valuable, beautiful glass beads and stuff, you know. And the Indians thought, wow, that's incredible. We get all this incredible beauty, and you just have this, you know, this land. Hey, why not? Great deal. Well, didn't turn out to be a very good deal for the Indians. So, you know, all this faux spirituality that belief is offering is like, you know, glass beads, and it may seem beautiful on the surface, all this multimedia, you know, stuff that we can, you know, touch phones and share everything, like just touch phones. Oh, we shared all this pictures, you know, we shared pictures. At first blush, it, you know, might seem really cool, but, you know, it's been, you know, quite some, you know, time now. We've been, you know, up to this stuff, and it should be dawning on us now that it's just glass beads, you know. There's no there, really. There's nothing really that we really, really want, that we really want. There's no, you know, it's so superficial. It's laughable. And, you know, we're supposed to settle for that. We think, you know, that's we're really sophisticated, really advanced, and we're waiting, you know, for, you know, to be recognized as super advanced. So it has been difficult, super difficult during these times, because belief was so vastly threatened by some super teachers, and some super teaching really came in. The super teachers, there were a number of them. The ones I know for sure who were super teachers in the 20th century was Ramana Maharshi and Ananda Maya Ma. Those two were definitely super teachers, you know. 100%. I'm 100% certain of that. Now, there were some other teachers that I'm not as, you know, certain of, but they could have been, too. It's possible, sure. Absolutely. So, that, you know, and then there was also in A Course in Miracles coming out, and, you know, people started reading it in 1974. That was extremely threatening to belief, extremely threatening. And, you know, it just responded with, you know, everything it's got. Let's bring the tech people in, you know, let's get them in here right now. You know, there's a crisis, there's an emergency. Really, I mean, from the standpoint of belief, it's like an incredible superstorm hit in the 20th century of truth. And, you know, from the standpoint of belief, it's like an ultimate disaster struck, you know, worse than Sandy, you know, worse than Katrina. Some horrendous calamity occurred. So it rushed all its first responders into this world, into incarnation, saying, you guys got to get here and get here now and plug that dike. Because the dike has sprung a terrible, you know, terrible leaks on the dike. And if we don't stop those leaks, the whole dike system's going to fail, and we're going to be flooded. The whole world's going to be flooded with truth. What a disaster that's going to be, belief is saying, you know. So it hustled all its first responders into this world as fast as possible. And they started churning out all these glass beads, you know, all this technology, all this faux spirituality as fast as possible, and marketing it like crazy, you know. And so the world now is absolutely super saturated with that. And belief is like, you know, it's winded, you know, it's very winded. And now it says, you know, it's so upset, it's coming in here now, make sure it never happens again. So it's going to, you know, crack down on truth in this world. It's going to bring the full scope of its intimidation to bear upon the planet. So everybody will bow down to belief and swear they'll never, ever, ever consider truth ever again. That's what belief is aiming at. So it's aiming at, you know, extreme totalitarian, fascist, super control, central planning bureaucracy, one world order bureaucracy of elites dictating to the rest of the world how everything has to be, with super control over every facet of our lives. That's exactly what it's aiming for. It's brought all its engineers of that, who know how to engineer that in the world, has brought them all into incarnation here. And they're all here now. They're all working frantically to please belief, you know, because belief gets all huffy, you know, when it feels threatened, it gets very huffy, and it intimidates the heck out of those who work for belief, you know. It's like a tyrant. People are, you know, terrified, you know, I got to get in here, and they'll work around the clock, you know, take drugs. I mean, the people who developed the high-tech gadgetry now, you know, took, you know, it was caffeine and cocaine. Everybody knows that. That was in the industry. And they worked like crazy. I mean, oh my gosh, I would see some people. They lived on junk food, candy bars, you know, candy bars and caffeine. Three C's, cocaine, candy bars, and caffeine. And they'd just go 24 hours a day. I mean, they would just push through code until they finished the job nonstop. They drove themselves, you know, almost to death, really. Because they're under, you know, severe fear from belief that they had to get this job done pronto, right now, no delay. And so, of course, those of us who are oriented towards truth, we're kind of like going along and thinking everything's going to be great. I mean, we're all grooving on the high of the 60s, you know, that Ramana built up, that Anandamaya Ma built up, and then the 70s comes along with the Course in Miracles, and of course other teachers from other traditions had built up a tremendous spiritual groove, you know, and we're all thinking this, oh, everything's great, we're gonna, you know, succeed. And then this backlash came from belief, which was, you know, hit us like broadside, like a tsunami, you know. And really, a tsunami of belief came into this world and knocked us all for a loop, really, into all sorts of compromised situations and clutching, you know, and we are trying to, you know, get the groove back. And it's really like a full-time job. I've worked at it full-time, every single day. It's very difficult. And we're starting now to get that groove back, standing up to the bully of belief. And those who have survived this tsunami of belief are now in a position to be very strong, very adamant, and very clear about it. But it had not been easy. It's been the ultimate difficulty, really. Extraordinarily difficult. Because the backlash from belief was off the charts. Has been off the charts. Continues to be off the charts. It's getting worse and worse and worse. And we have an election coming up soon, which is going to, again, just throw a monkey wrench into this stuff so badly. You know, now they're saying, oh, you know, getting us ready for recounts, of course, which is something I've foreseen way, way back. There's a very strong possibility. It's going to be severe turmoil. Recounts is a very strong possibility because the election's likely to be razor thin close. And there are states then who can insist on recounts, and this is going to throw all sorts of legal challenges into the situation, and those legal challenges are going to start working their way through the, you know, court systems, and eventually it may end up at the Supreme Court again, like in 2000, the hanging chad kind of thing. And so you could have the election results delayed through January. I mean, you know, and then there's all this fiscal stuff cliff in January. You know, it's like a superstorm. It's coming, superstorm. And you know, and we combine that with all the faux spirituality and all the gadgetry and all this stuff. It's designed to knock you off course. Which is why these videos are being made. Which is to, just so you get the feel, the flavor that you can stay on course. It's possible. It's possible. Absolutely possible. You have enough clarity, it's absolutely possible to stay on course. But you have to can maintain your good habits of satsang, of inquiry, of consideration. Keeping yourself on course is necessary. I might have to take a short break here. We'll see. Just 1 minute. Be right back. All right, see, easy. Sometimes you have to take a short break. It's very possible. Okay. All right, back again, quick. You have situations where you need to take, you know, a short break, and then boom, right back. That's par for the course. The important thing is to not take long breaks from your inquiry. Don't take long breaks. That'll break you. If there's some emergency, you know, even within an emergency, don't take long breaks. That's what all this turmoil is designed for, okay? I'll tell you exactly what it's designed for. It's supposed to be something that is so important for your attention that you decide you really need to follow this, and that the inquiry has to wait until it's resolved. But you think it's going to be resolved quickly. So you say, well, I'll follow this until it's resolved, but I think it'll only be a couple days or a week. What happens is it drags on and on and on and on. That's exactly the whole purpose of it. That belief sets all this up, is to fool you that way. So what you have to do is say, you might say, well, I need to follow this, fine, but say, but first I need to do satsang every day, so I'll do that first, and then whatever time left, if I have to follow it, I'll follow it, or maybe not. That is what you have to do. Otherwise, you'll get strung along, and before you know it, you've spent a couple months, and you've dropped inquiry completely, and you'll find that it's hard to pick up the thread again. You know, it can be difficult. You become vulnerable to other delays. All this stuff is just delay tactics by belief. All of it. The whole 2000 thing with the hanging chad and all that stuff. That too was simply delaying tactics. You know, you kept thinking, every day you thought it's going to be resolved. It's like, I want to know who the new president is. I got to follow this. And you know, it kept going on and on and on and on and on. And severe distraction. Severe. Can't do that now. You cannot do that, because then there's all these, this faux spirituality which you become vulnerable to at that point, and you will grab a hold of it. There's compromised teachings, which basically our belief is belief claiming that it's the one that's flexible, and it's teaching you flexibility. flexibility, compromise, integration, flexibility, something between truth and lies, something between endlessness and an end. What could be between? How can endlessness have a between? That's ludicrous. Something between invulnerability and vulnerability. How can invulnerability have a between? Between what? No, reality doesn't have any betweenness. It's reality, and then there's something else, and there's something between that something else, and then no such thing, no situation at all in reality. So ludicrous. What belief is offering us, what belief is peddling, is insanity. That's it. Nothing more than that. Belief literally is peddling insanity to us and saying, trying to sugarcoat it and distract us away from recognizing that's what it's peddling to us by, you know, all these so-called very, you know, consequential situations like, who's the next president? We got to know. And we'll follow this drama that unfolds, you know, as this big fight. I mean, it's looking like that's a very likely scenario, that there will be a legal, the whole thing will be turned over to the courts. Very possible. I mean, I don't see either side not doing that in a close election, right? Neither side is going to, concede. When it's super close, and the whole thing could be changed by a recount or something, they're not going to concede. And then they get into the faulty voting machines and the faulty, all the voting shenanigans that's going on even now, and people not having an opportunity to vote, etc. In a super razor close election, you're going to have legal challenges saying that these people were disenfranchised from voting because of, you know, some chicanery, whatever, and therefore the vote count is not legal, and these people need to be able to vote, and their votes have to be counted, and there's illegal challenges will abound. Already the grounds for these are there, and the legal bigwigs are already circling the wagons, getting ready for a legal fight. So we may very well not have a president after on November 6th, okay? Quite likely. And even if we do, you know, all the faux spirituality, all the faux teachings, all of the marketing that's going on by belief is still, the momentum is, the avalanche is still going on, unimpeded. It's just very possible it could become much, much worse soon. Just like, you know, Sandy, they saw it coming, they say, this doesn't look good, and we're not sure what's going to happen. You know, look what happened. It was really bad. Really, really bad. So when those people say, look, this is possible, that's what I'm doing. I'm saying, I'm like a forecaster of like a storm, saying, I'm seeing very strong indications that this storm could happen. You know, this political, legal storm. The you know, the high pressure's up here, and the low pressure's over here, and the cold front's coming in here, and the hurricane's coming up from here, and the tropical moisture. And I'm saying, you know, that this doesn't look good. The variables are there for it, very much so. So you have to be forewarned. And to be forewarned is to be forearmed, you know, and means to recognize that this is a distraction event. This is an attempt to distract you. Belief is trying to hide the truth of the situation from you, keep you from recognizing that all it's peddling is insanity. It has nothing that you really want. It will never have anything you really want. It's simply trying to delay the inevitable, which is you choosing a new idea. And it is trying to bully you and intimidate you and threaten you and frighten you from seeing this. And it's that you will accept a distraction, a plausible distraction, in exchange for it not threatening, bullying you directly, threatening you directly. You'll think, well, I've got an excuse. I need to follow this election, that find out, you know, who's going to be president. I got to follow this. And that you think that's better than having belief come after me directly and scream at me that I'm totally incompetent. You know, you're afraid of that. On the other hand, you have a situation here of someone who's not afraid of belief insisting that I'm incompetent. I've already been through that. So I'm able to continue to belief, you know, force belief out of the closet so you can see what it's all about. And that you can recognize that there's an easy, clear choice to be made because you're choosing between two inflexibilities, two positions, either this or that. And there is no third option. There is no third option. I have to keep telling you this. No third option whatsoever. And therefore, all these offerings that claim they're coming from this third option are a lie. They're coming from belief. And again, belief, the third option is, again, it's just in the way of restating the belief that reality can be changed. That's it. It's all exactly the same. Just saying reality can be changed. And here's how we're going to do it. It's just saying there's a clever way to do it. We're going to integrate it. We're not really getting rid of reality. We're just changing it. Or something, you know, that to change reality is to get rid of it, because the whole nature of reality is that it's unchangeable. If you could change reality, there would be no more reality. Reality is unchangeable. That's what it is. All of reality, the way that it is unchangeable. If you could even change the tiniest bit, it wouldn't be what it is at all. It'd be no more reality whatsoever. So keep all this in mind. And how much time we're working? 52 minutes. Well, beautiful here, of course, in California. We only, you know, get the killer earthquakes occasionally, which is, you know, bound to come some point. And then we'll have our, you know, ultra disaster here for sure, which will probably be, you know, maybe worse than, you know, any Sandy or Katrina. Who knows? Could be. You get like an, you know, an 8.2 or 9.0 or something here, you know, in Los Angeles or the Bay Area, you know, you're looking at trouble. That is for sure. And of course, we don't know when it's coming, supposedly. We're not supposed to know. And where is it with, whoops, low bandwidth. Okay. For some reason, this it suddenly went to low bandwidth, so it might drop out here. Okay, it came back. Now, it's getting buggy. It's getting buggy. Warning. Low bandwidth. Okay, so if it drops out, it drops out. We've said what we need to say here. And don't know why it's doing this. Anyway, for now, everything's, you know, great out here in California. That, you know, I'll tell you, the truth is that people out here on the West Coast really cannot relate to the troubles back east. Really cannot. Very difficult. Really. I mean, I looked at the paper this morning, and there was, on the front page, there was absolutely nothing about the crisis back east. Nothing. You know, it was all about, you know, tech companies and what's going on out here, and I don't know. It was pretty strange. Pretty strange. You'd think that'd be front page news, right? So, for a country to really unify in purpose. Usually wars do that. You know, World War II did that. But yeah, most people out here, you know, they just kind of have a vague awareness that things aren't so good back east, but that's about it. Well wishes, of course, but you know, out here it's, you know, the crickets are chirping. It's very calm, it's very beautiful, and you know, gas is going down under $4. And probably because the demand back east is just dropped, you know, down to almost nothing, because people can't drive. So of course, less demand, the price drops. You would think that in a crisis like this, the price of gas would shoot up. Well, it is, for people who are gouging, right? But because the demand has dropped so severely, you know, the price drops when the demand drops. I mean, if we wanted to drop the price of gas, all we'd have to do is everybody in the country, you know, go to work on a bike for a week, you know, and nobody use any gas at all for a week, and you'd see the price drop down to probably $2 a gallon or something. I mean, it would plummet. Absolutely would plummet. It probably would be a good thing to do, you know, but it's not really feasible for most of us. But, you know, if everybody carpooled, if everybody just dropped the usage, the price would go way, way down. Okay, the bandwidth is still going. So we're only, what is this, November 2nd? Or is it the first? It's the second. It's the second. So, I mean, the election is 4 days away. 4 days away. Which means we literally could be, we're on the doorstep. Hey, cat. The cat's getting restless. On the doorstep of really big time turmoil. You add this turmoil on top of Sandy problem. That's a pretty interesting name for a name that pushed all the sand up, you know, onto the coast and tore all the sand away, etc. Sandy, you know, very apropos name. We're at that stage where it's a domino effect now. Really, I've said for you know, I've been on posting here for actually about, what, I don't know, 3-4 years. Before that, also posted way back for a long time on YouTube, but mostly didn't have much response, so I just dropped the various channels, etc. Closed them out. But been posting for, you know, here for over a year, and saying that there's a domino effect coming. There's a domino effect coming, which is what I've been warning about. That's the problem. It's not isolated instances that are the problem. It's domino effect stacking up one thing on top of another, on top of another. So we have Sandy, and then this is going to be piggybacked by the election. And then the election is going to be piggybacked by all the, you know, the legal troubles, challenges, etc. And that will then piggyback into this fiscal cliff that we're coming up. I mean, there's a lot of people selling businesses now because of the capital gains hit. The hit of profit from selling a business is going, you know, it's going to go from whatever, what is it, 13 now or 17 or something, maybe 13 up to 20 something. You know, I mean, massive difference in taxation. So a lot of businesses are just saying, hey, we are going to divest of our business right now before the new tax law is going to affect. I think the least that's going to happen is the new medical plan is going to bump up the tax rate significantly up to, I think, to 17 something from maybe 13 or something like that. It's all very significant when you're talking about large quantities of money, very significant. So there are massive changes coming, and of course the economy is still stagnant and probably could very well become much, much more stagnant when the new, you know, the tax situation gets reshuffled, the whole medical situation gets reshuffled, and you have that. That's a huge piggyback domino effect, is the new medical care system going into places is chaos. You know, it's just going to be unbelievable. It's already, we're experiencing the impact of that already. A lot of very difficult stuff for doctors to deal with. It's going to really hit doctors extremely hard and their patients extremely hard. That effect, you have the drought and the food price effect, like the severe drought that's been taking place and the lack of those staples, you know, soy and corn, etc. That'll trickle down. You have the gas situation that you know, could have problems. You could have a war starting. You could have all sorts of stuff, domino effects, one after the other after the other. And you get, eventually, the straw breaks the camel's back, you know. You get people developing a hysterical attitude of mind, which actually has, people have already been working on that, actually have been kind of prescripting a type of hysteria. And you have all these, you know, the media and the pop culture teaching incivility, extreme rudeness, extreme aggressiveness, extreme violence as a way of dealing with situations. You know, basically they show people going, the way to deal with a situation is to go berserk, you know, and commit mayhem. That's what we see. You know, of course the heroes are doing it against the villains, you know, the bad people. But when you watch all that, it's scripting. It's helping you script how your reactions should go. You're scripting it. You're writing software, essentially, for your own body-mind. That's exactly what the whole purpose of movies and television and pop culture is all about, has been used that way, too. It's writing software for the body-mind. And when we pay attention to that, we are programming. We're writing code. Absolutely. We're being coded and also writing code. We write code, both. It's just like now they've taught machines how to write code. These movies are actually a way of coding our reactions and behavior. Absolutely is that, which is why I don't watch any movies at all. I don't watch movies, don't watch television. I watch baseball games, but you know, then they try to code those too with the commercials. But I prefer to listen to baseball games, actually. There's less coding taking place in the commercials there. I still try, of course. You know, and the coding for the young people is off the charts with all these, you know, video games that they're trying to sell. It's just, you know, they're coding in extreme mayhem, you know, as appropriate, you know, as coding for their behavior. So when civilization starts domino affecting, affects these dominoes coming down, affects civilization, it gets to the point where then this coded behavior then starts to rise to the surface and seems appropriate. We say, you know, here we are in this scenario that I've already coded in, you know, by all these video games and movies and television and books and mass media and all this kind of multimedia, whatever. Then the software, the coding, you know, runs. You run it. You press, you know, press play. Run it. Run the code. And then you start engaging in mayhem. It's exactly the situation that's been pre-planned, pre-coded, and is ready to go. And of course, we have a veneer of sophistication. But you know, you see people like road rage. You know, you see people that they seem, you know, driving along. And I experienced that one time up in Marin. Marin's supposed to be a laid-back, cool place. Actually, it's not. It's not at all. Caffeine freaks up there. I mean, people are just like, you know, when road rage was really a problem. My gosh, I didn't know the area at all. I've never been on the street in my life. And I'm driving along and I realize I'm in a turn only lane and I need to get over or something like that. And so I held somebody up for like 20 seconds or something, you know. And they went crazy. They went absolutely crazy, you know. It's like they want to commit mayhem on you because you held them up for 20 seconds. You know, what are you doing in my world? Nobody holds me up for 20 seconds. Because again, those are the people who are on the cocaine, candy bars and caffeine, and I can add cigarettes, which, you know, became somewhat passe. But those are the people who were on all this stuff, you know. They've got their, you know, yuppie cars and their yuppie lifestyle and stuff, but they're driving themselves bananas, and they can't slow down for anything. And so, you know, 20 seconds in their world is like, you know, an eternity. You know, they got to get this done now, you know, because belief is threatening them so bad. If they fail, belief is going to start screaming, you're incompetent. And then that gets into, eventually belief, you know, their afraid belief will say, you're totally incompetent. And since they believe that belief is created them, their afraid belief is going to disown them and destroy them. And so they're terrified of this. So, you know, they can't be slowed down. And you have situations here in the Bay Area. I don't know how it is in the rest of the country, in the world, but if you're going slow, if you're slowing down for construction, if you're, you know, various situations where you're supposed to be going slow, or you're turning, or, you know, all sorts of situations, people will simply go around you on the right, on the shoulder, just go right past you. Insanely dangerous situations. I've had numerous times where if I hadn't have been very alert and respectful and caring about my environment and situation, and saying, maybe that somebody might try to do something really stupid. If I hadn't have thought about that, if I had been in a rush, accident, bad accidents would happen for sure. People trying to pass on the right, on a shoulder, places where they have absolutely no business passing whatsoever. In crazy situations, you know, situations if I didn't slow down, they could have killed somebody, you know. Because they can't slow down. They can't slow down. They can't, they cannot. They're terrified of the bully of belief is going to sit there incompetent, and they're, so they feel the, their fate depends on them coming through for belief and distracting everybody from truth, and they're desperate to accomplish this, you know. They're under the gun, severely under the gun, and then they try to put all the rest of us under the gun. That's a fact. The people, the leaders, you know, in this world are under the gun. And there's those behind the scenes, you know, putting them under the gun. And it's really belief that is putting them under the gun. And they feel they need to take desperate measures to control the world. Really, they feel they're control freaks, really. People who are rising up into positions of control, authority in the world, are control freaks now. And they feel they need to control everyone to the nth degree to make... to please, to calm down belief, because belief is really upset. Belief is really upset. Because, you know, the ambassador's reality came into the world. I mean, Ananda Mayama really upset belief severely. Really severely. I mean, you might think everybody loved her. No, there were many in India and in the world that were very, very upset with her. Really. They're furious with her. And she always said, you know, that she wore this as her ornaments. You know, those who were, you know, very angry and upset with her were the ornaments that she wore, and she gladly accepted all this. You know, she's just like, said, this is great. You know, love it. It's my the ornaments. But you don't hear that side of it. But the fact is that there were those who were not pleased at all. At all. And there were a lot of those who tried to imitate her. Belief tried to imitate her. There's a lot of wannabe copycats of Ananda Mayama. Tried to look like her, tried to adopt a name similar to hers, and who offer compromised teaching. They're trying to appease belief. Belief was very upset with her that she came in here and completely disregarded belief 100%. Not even there for her. Non-existent for her. And that threatened the heck out of belief, and belief has fought back severely. Trying to imitate, but offering a faux, you know, faux Ananda Mayama, faux this, faux that, fake that, compromise this and that. And it is still, you know, desperately fighting back against any other situation like that. No, the belief is desperate to prevent any other instance like that. Like Jesus, like Ananda Mayama, like anyone who completely disregards belief 100%. Trying to prevent that from happening. It's trying to build a spiritual culture in the world, a faux spiritual culture that will say, we don't need that. We don't want that. We've got this compromise. That's what we want. We're working on that. We believe we can accomplish this. We have no need for anybody who's 100%er. No need. And it's desperately trying to bring that about. So you have all these people, you know, working with all this, you know, multimedia, you know, high-tech stuff, trying to satisfy our urge, you know, for something profound, except make sure it's not 100%, you know, that's a compromise. And I've been working to try to bring back 100%er. I want 100%er back here. Absolutely. I don't want a compromise. I want 100%er here. And whereas belief is frantically working to prevent that. So when I said, no, I want 100% or belief, you know, lowered the incompetence claim, you know, boom on me. which, you know, was at the time was devastating. But, you know, I was able to, you know, dig out from underneath that. Because obviously if you want 100% or that dismisses belief completely, that's, you're saying belief, you're the one that's incompetent, belief. And belief is totally incompetent because it can't deliver what it's promising to deliver. Can never deliver it. It's 100% incompetent. And so belief doesn't want that to be known. See, you get 100%er in the world and you will know that belief isn't completely incompetent and you will set it down and choose a new idea. Belief doesn't want that. Belief wants to remain, you know, in authority, in charge, large and in charge. So it insist that those who want 100% in this world, they're the ones who are incompetent. They're the ones who are completely crazy, completely insane. And so it tries to bring to the top those who accept sacrifice. They say, well, let's bring in a 99%er, you know, 99.9%er. Let's bring that in. And they're all working on that. And I say, no way, because that is, you're bringing in just a dressed up version of insanity. Still, anyone who believes that truth is 99.99% true is completely insane. Completely insane. That's belief. Truth is 100% true. It's not 99.99% true. It's 100%. Without any possibility of it being 99.99%. Because that means there's part of it that's not true. There's part of it that's it's changeable. It means it's changeable. Which means it's mutable. Which means it's not endless. Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Which means it's not real. So, those who are trying to bring in a 99.99%er, that's belief that's doing that. I don't want that, I want a 100%er. And we think we can't handle 100%er. I can handle 100%er, bring it in, you know. What's belief going to do? Say I'm completely incompetent. Well, been there, done that. Bring Jesus back. Bring it on to my back. Bring 100%er back. Here, whatever. Doesn't matter who it is. Just bring 100%er here. No deals, you know. No deals, Mr. Bond. No deals. You know. And then belief will say, ah, you know. What a crazy, radical extremist. They want 100% when they could have a 99.99% and there'd be peace in the golden age on the planet. If you just accept that, then they're causing all the trouble. No, that is absolute nonsense. Because with going with belief, you have the same old, same old, same old. No different whatsoever. You have nothing but dead ends. Nothing but dead ends. Nothing but lies. Nothing of any value. Nothing you really want. Just futility and death. Futility and death is all you're going to get from a 99.999%er. That's all you're going to get. So, you know, pray for a 100%er. Get yourself ready for a 100%er. I'm not afraid of a 100%er. Not at all. I keep saying, come on, 100%er. Come on, show up, please. You know, I'm not afraid of it at all. What's the worst that can happen? Worst that can happen is that belief will disown you and say you're irreversibly completely incompetent with no possibility of ever being either any other way, and say, okay, whatever, you know, what does belief know? Belief knows nothing. Belief knows nothing about reality, nothing at all. So it's just gibberish. Belief is nothing but gibberish, really. It believes in its gibberish, but that's, it doesn't mean it has any meaning. It has no meaning at all. Completely insane. So all its accusations are meaningless, and they're not true either. You know, they say, "Ah, you're gonna make things worse." Not true. You know, this upsurge in faux spirituality seems to have made things worse. It hasn't. It's a desperation ploy by belief. And when you're able to, you know, survive this and get through it and see it, then, you know, whew, belief is really, and even, you know, you've saved massive delay. So the big picture is to save time, save delay, so you don't delay so long. And in that regard, we've saved massive amounts of delay. You know, all those who have working on this 100%er plan of God, God's grace, save a massive amount of delay. Who knows how much? It's immeasurable how much delay has already been saved, and we're saving even more. So on the short term, you might say, well, things have gotten, you know, more intense and more faux spirituality, more belief is frantically defending itself, which is true. So short term, it seems very difficult. But on the long term, it saved a massive amount of delay, for sure. and you have to take, you know, a long-term picture. You got to look at it, because that is the situation. Is belief will delay indefinitely. That's all it does, is delay. So to the extent that you're still intimidated by belief, you're going to delay. You'll accept a compromise, which is really nothing more than delay. That's all it is. All these compromised positions of belief are nothing but delay. Delay tactics of belief. That's all it is. And so the more that you can, you know, get your clarity up, get your clarity going, the more you can feel that you can withstand the, you know, the wrath of being called an incompetent by what you believe is God, which isn't really God at all, it's belief, then the more delay you're saving from everybody else. You're helping everyone else. Everyone. Helping the whole universe, actually. You can be sitting right here helping the entire universe, saving tremendous amount of time for everyone to, you know, stand up to that bully of belief and set it down. You're bringing that point nearer to them, much nearer, making it much easier, you know, for them to stand up. You know, I mean, how would I have been able to stand up to the bully of belief without Ramana Maharshi, without Ananda Maima, without Jesus, without A Course in Miracles, without Buddha? How would I have been able to stand up to the bully belief? I couldn't have done it without Shankara, you know? Another great, great, great ambassador of truth, Shankara, teaching the non-dual, you know, teaching of Advaita, non-dual teaching. Great, great teacher, ambassador of truth. And there are lots of others, really, throughout history. It's not my purpose to name them all, you know, like so that I don't leave some out. I'm just talking about the ones that I have, you know, been helped the most by. Without them, there's no way I could have stood up to it. Not so quickly, you know, not so quickly. It might have taken me millions and millions more years or something. So these teachers of reality, ambassadors of reality, greatly accelerate our capacity to stand up to that bully of belief. Greatly help us. You know, I studied the life of Ananda Maima. I just said, wow, I saw each instance how she stood up to belief like it was nothing. And I said, this is incredible. How does she do it? How does she do it? I couldn't believe it. It's beyond belief. I keep expecting her to crumple, you know, or at least, you know, like, you know, this belief, you know, threatens her, you know, to you know, some reaction, something to acknowledge belief. No, she didn't even acknowledge it. No trouble whatsoever. I said, wow, it's possible. What I thought might not be possible is possible, as far as, you know, she's not intimidated, not even the slightest bit intimidated. I said, holy cow, how's she doing that? You know, what's the secret? There is a way. I knew there's a way, but wow. That's incredible. That's amazing. Amazing. I mean, I recognize she's doing it, but it's amazing. Really amazing. How can you not be even the slightest bit intimidated by belief? Here I am, you know, cowering in dread of belief, you know, this ferocity and the charges that levels against me. And she's not even the slightest bit worried about it. Where'd you get that? You know, where'd you get that? How did you manage that to do that? That's the ultimate accomplishment. You know, so I tried to, you know, pay attention. And I said, well, I know it's possible. Not sure how to do it, but it must be a way. If it's possible, there must be a way. So let's, you know, let's keep working at it. And then you reread like A Course in Miracles, and you see, you know, whoever wrote that, it's supposed to be Jesus, is absolutely not intimidated by belief in the slightest bit. Not in the slightest bit. And then I said that, wow, here's another one. And then Ramana, another one. Say, wow, it's not just one. There's you know, there's others too that are not intimidated by it. So, and then when I had that experience with Ramana in a sleep, in a vision during sleep, where he said, you know, you can do it. You're doing it. Just keep doing what you're doing. You'll do it. You'll get there. And I said, wow, if he assures me I can get there for sure, then that, you know, I believe what, you know, I can accept that, because he's certain about it. You know, he says, you know, you may be intimidated now, but you won't always be. Okay, so just stay with it. And I said, wow, that's great gravitas there. So I'll keep working at it. Same thing. So that helps. You get that help that tells you, yes, you can do it. And then, you know, then it doesn't be, it's not as tough. You got an ally, you know. When belief tries to, you know, intimidate me, I say, well, wait a minute, you know. And onto my mock and do it, and you know, so I know it's possible, and I understand kind of where she's coming from, so it's not, you know, I know, you know, I'm sure I can do it too, because she said, Jesus said, I, you know, these, what I did, you can do too. And on my mock says, you can do it. Ramana says, you can do it. Yes, you can. So you say to belief, hey, you know, you're telling me I can't do it? That's another lie. It's just a matter of time before I manage to do it somehow. And belief says, yeah, but how are you going to do it? And I said, I don't know, but I know I'm going to, and it won't be long. And belief says, ah, you don't know, you're bluffing. I said, no, I'm not bluffing. And belief kind of, ah, screams at me, swears at me. And oh, I tell you, there's been like about three situations, I think, that I can recall. Probably a lot more than that. Oh, no, there's been more than that. No, way more than that. Where I just had one actually 2 nights ago. Yeah, it was 2 nights ago. Holy cow. Exactly right. Where I asked for something back from someone. I'd given to someone that was a unity. It wasn't a pair. It wasn't duality. It was a unity. It was a oneness. It was symbolizing the dream. And this someone who supposedly had been keeping it in storage for me, wouldn't give it back to me. He said, no, you don't need that. It's not a pair. It's just one. I said, well, that's fine. That's what I want. I want that just the one, not a paired. You know, not immutability and mutability together, and not endlessness and end together, but just one. I want that. And they said, no. You don't want it. It's worthless to you. And I said, well, it's mine, so I'm telling you to give it back to me. And they said, no, I'm keeping it. You lost your title to it by letting me have it. I said, no, I didn't. It's mine. So we got in this ferocious argument. I mean, I was calm, but I insisted on it being given back to me. And the one who was insisting they weren't going to give it back to me was extremely angry and upset. Just was, you know, fuming mad. And I just stood my ground. I said, no, you're giving that back to me. And they said, no, it's mine. You lost title to it. You can't have it back. It's worthless to you. I know better than you. You got no right to it. You're crazy. You're incompetent. You don't, you know, you should be committed because you're crazy. You're asking for what this and it's not yours. And threatening. And I said, no, it's mine. You're giving it back to me. So that just was 2 nights ago. So I've had actually innumerable situations through the years where I had to stand up to belief and insisted on getting what is mine back, you know. Getting truth back, you know, from belief, and it absolutely refused to do so, and we got into an extremely intense showdown. Many instances, actually. I think there were three that stood out for me for their incredible ferocity and intensity, which was nerve shaking, to say the least. But I stood my ground, and all of those, I stood my ground. But my nerves were badly shaken from that. The dream 2 nights ago, my nerves are not shaken. I do feel very tired today. Last couple of days, I felt exhausted. That is true. I didn't know why, but it was actually probably from that dream. Because I have to get that unity back, that realizing the inflexibility of reality and belief. And you can only choose one. You can't choose both, you see. And that belief is saying, no, you have to get two, you know, and choose both. You know, whereas integrate the two. You have two inflexibilities. Actually, what I was looking at like was like skis or inflexible. It's kind of something like it's very inflexible. Some kind of rigid, inflexible material. And I'm supposed to get two of them and then work on, you know, integrating the two of them. And I said, no, I'll take those, but I also have just one, and I want that one back. And that's when the argument ensued. I said, you can't have it back. It's no good for you. We don't want you to have it. And I say, well, I want to have it. And they say, well, who are you? You know, we're saying we're not giving it to you. And I'm saying, well, you're out of luck because I'm insisting on it. And the fact is, we are the authority of this dream. This whole scenario, we're the authority. We are the spirit is the authority. And so by I insisted that I was a higher authority than the one that's saying it's not giving it back to me, and they had to give it back. But they were super angry about it. And, well, and mocking, you know, sarcastic and mocking, like, oh, this little, you know, this little fellow wants it back. How cute, you know, trying to mock me as I was just some little fool, you know, some little nothing that was wanting this back. And, you know, how sweet, how silly, just all this kind of mockery, right? That was used too. That's been used too. If it can't intimidate you through fear, it mocks you. And Jesus said, of course, God is not mocked. Don't worry about it. Don't think that, don't let mockery, you know, undermine you at all, because reality cannot be undermined by mockery either. So mockery is the flip side of the, you know, intimidation, terror tactics of fear, trying to intimidate you, threaten you. Then it flips over. Can't do that. It tries to mock you. And so it tried to do that, to make you seem silly to ask that for that unity back, unity consciousness, unity realization of oneness, the unchangeableness of reality, one without a second. Make you feel silly for doing that. Like you're completely silly, and laugh at you, like, oh, you know, only a complete idiot would ask for that. How pity you, you know, tries to pity you, mock you, pity you, all this stuff. I just still said, hey, whatever, give it back. Didn't faze me, you know. Obviously, it fazed me a little bit because I'm feeling tired, nervous, like I went through an ordeal. But, you know, not so bad. The spiritual path is an ordeal. It really is. And that's why there needs to be help on the path. Because belief will threaten you and it will mock you, both. And it's shocking, you know. What you thought was your friend suddenly turns on you. That's what happens, you know. You have dreams where you think someone's your best friend, and suddenly your best friend becomes ferocious and turns on you and becomes, you know, like trying to, you know, totally threaten you and mock you. And you think, oh my gosh, what happened? Then you realize belief is not your friend. Belief is not your friend. It's nobody's friend. It's not even a friend to itself. It's insanity. Insanity is not a friend to anyone, to anything. Right? It is not. The belief that the impossible can be accomplished is not a friend to anything at all. Anything. There's only what is real is all there is. And it's not trying to be a friend to what is real. It's not a friend to itself. It's not a friend to anything. Insanity. Saying, hey, we've got something better. We got a blend of truth and lies. We're going to blend the two, and that's even better. No, it's not, because it can never be done. So it's insane to, you know, to wait for that, to believe that that's your friend. So you gradually realize this belief is not your friend, and belief gets really mad about that, really mad about it. Jesus enabled this whole thing to be dramatized externally by, you know, all the people wanting to put him to death and freeing the murderer, but wanting to put Jesus to death because belief was really mad at him. Totally mad. Totally upset. Because he, you know, brought the whole thing out in the open and exposed belief's insanity and showed that we don't really want that. And belief, you know, just was incensed. And people thought, well, if we let Jesus be crucified, that will satisfy belief's fury, you know. And then they made built a religion around that, that said, don't worry about belief, its anger has been permanently satisfied by the sacrifice of Jesus, so it'll never get angry with us anymore, you know. And we showed our loyalty to belief forever, you know. But not true, because belief is still nothing. Still completely threatened by reality, completely threatened by us, because we will eventually recognize it is nothing. It is nothing but insanity. It has nothing to offer us, and we will choose a new idea. And it knows that. So it didn't, you know, crucifying Jesus didn't change anything, didn't solve any problem at all. Belief is still completely threatened by us, and it's just that we think we can submit to belief somehow forever, and that will solve the problem. Not true. Not true. We can never submit to Jesus to belief forever. We must submit to truth forever, because we already are inherently one with truth and reality. So we believe that we can submit to belief forever. Just call belief God, say that we are willing to kill God. Essentially, God's Son is of course, an extension of God. We're willing to kill God, meaning we're willing to completely submit to belief. And whatever angers belief, we're willing to sacrifice. In other words, the truth. We're willing to sacrifice reality. Jesus was, of course, an ambassador of reality. So we were willing to sacrifice reality to please belief and try to show us that we're loyal forever to belief, thinking then, believing that that would cause belief to then love us, you know, love us. No, belief doesn't love us. Belief hates us because it feels completely threatened by us. How can it not? How can insanity not feel threatened by sanity? Of course it's threatened, always will be. So there is no tricky, magical solution like sacrifice to the situation. You know, sacrifice what belief hates the most, which is, you know, reality, an ambassador of reality, and then somehow belief will say, ah, okay, I can trust you from forever now. No, because we are still one with reality, and belief is a denial of reality, so belief is totally threatened by us, totally. So could never love us, always will be fearful of us. Doesn't matter how much sacrifice we engage in, it doesn't have the slightest effect on belief, none whatsoever. And yet we make a religion based on sacrifice, hoping that it will calm belief down. It doesn't. It does not. And Jesus absolutely has pointed this out in A Course in Miracles. Set the record straight. Thank you, Jesus, for doing that, because we have been under very strong, you know, insistence that we accept, you know, a religion of sacrifice, the sacrificial belief system, as if that's somehow the remedy, when it's not at all. And of course, everyone's told us that Jesus wants us to accept this sacrificial belief system, which is not true. It's belief that wants us to. And we believe belief is God, so we believe that God wants us to. Not true. This does not calm belief down. It does not take away belief's fear of us. It doesn't, and therefore belief's hatred of us and belief's attempt to wipe us out. It doesn't. Belief is completely threatened by us. It doesn't matter how much we proclaim submission to sacrifice and say we are willing to sacrifice truth for you. Truth cannot be sacrificed. And the resurrection proved that. Okay? We only sacrificed it symbolically. It's a symbolic sacrifice, but Jesus, the truth was not, spirit was not sacrificed. The truth was not sacrificed at all. Just the form that was sacrificed. And Jesus said, hey, here I am again, folks. You know, okay, get it right here. And so, you know, sacrifice does nothing to belief. Nothing ever will ever do anything at all to remedy the situation we're in. Only choosing a new idea remedies the situation. That is it. Sacrifice has no effect on belief. None. In fact, it probably scares it even more, because it realizes that you're willing to sacrifice something. And it knows it's going to be belief that gets sacrificed, right? So it gets to evade you even more. Really, that's a fact. When you say, oh, I'm willing to sacrifice reality for you, belief. Belief is then says, oh my God, you know, it's willing to sacrifice what it really loves, and it thinks it believes it loves me, you know, and it's gonna sacrifice me. It's willing to do that. Scares the heck out of belief. Doesn't make it even so. It just makes the situation worse. Which is why I say, no sacrifice. You know, no sacrifice of ambassadors of reality. 100%ers. No way. I will not accept that whatsoever. Makes things worse. Okay. Now, maybe for a one-time thing, like in Jesus' situation, it was worth it in the big picture to point it out. Okay. But having done it and pointed this out doesn't need to be done again. And I think it's counterproductive to do it again, because it's only going to make belief even more frightened. You know, maybe we say we do it once, we say, okay, lesson learned, okay, then, you know, that's going to save us time. But if we do it again, lesson not learned, right? And then so belief's going to say, oh my gosh, they want to do it again, which means they didn't learn the lesson, which means they're diehard, and they're going to sacrifice me, belief. And so belief is going to really, 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 really feel so threatened and intimidated by that. Makes it worse. So no more sacrifice, okay? Of anyone. No sacrifice. Particularly of any 100%er that may come to this planet. No way. Just say, tell belief, hey, nope, you're out of luck. You know, we're not going to do that. Not going to do it. You have the authority to say that. Not going to do it. Now, for some reason, as it's written, Jesus, the plan was to do it one time, to expose totally expose belief for what it is and what's going on. Totally expose it. And then, having done that, that's enough. And then get to work on, you know, recognizing that what's going on, that sacrifice doesn't solve anything. But you kind of need to have the one sacrifice maybe to see, to recognize the whole situation as it is, that it doesn't solve anything, okay? But having done that, repeating it will then actually make things worse. So don't expect any 100%er to come here and offer themselves up for sacrifice. No way. And Aunt Jemima didn't do that. She was a 100%er. Nah, she lived a great life, you know, wasn't harmed or anything. You know, same with Ramana. He was not harmed. He didn't offer himself up on a cross or anything like that. No. And then the Course in Miracles, Jesus points out very clearly, sacrifice is completely futile. You have to give up the belief in sacrifice in order to be saved, which is entirely true. Because, again, that doesn't take away belief's insecurity. Belief is completely insecure. And there is no remedy for that insecurity except to set down the cause of belief and pick up a new cause that doesn't have belief arise at all. Belief will always be completely insecure, okay, because it's a denial of reality. So the only thing you can do with belief is to set it down and not have it arise in the first place, okay? That's all you can do. It's all anyone can do. If there is belief, there is 100% insecurity. If there's no belief, there's no insecurity. It's one or the other. Again, inflexible options. Totally inflexible options. When you go for a compromise, you lean back, you see, and you get the darkness, you know, on either side. Okay. And you say, okay, these are two inflexible options. You know, I'm going to choose truth. Choose truth. And then the duality disappears. You know, the belief that you can integrate both disappears. When you go back here, you try and say, okay, how do I integrate both? And you're stuck in trying to integrate the, you know, both of these. And you say, no. I choose just one. And then the duality disappears. You don't need to think in terms of duality anymore. It's irrelevant. Insanity is seen. It is completely irrelevant to reality. You don't have to struggle with trying to integrate endlessness and end with changelessness and changing, you know, impermanence. You don't have to try to integrate permanence and impermanence. So the permanence as a concept and impermanence as a concept, try to work with it. You don't need to do that. You just need to experience and abide in permanence. Not conceptually, but as abidance, actual experiencing. So it's always enjoyable to do these videos if I give the effort, you know, if the effort's there. That's enjoyable because I know I'm saving myself time, I'm saving you time, I'm saving the whole universe time. Any effort saves the whole universe time, actually. Your effort saves the whole, by watching this, you're saving the entire universe quite a bit of time before it finally is willing to, you know, the last intimidation is dropped, you know, by the last one who's afraid of belief, you know, finally gets to the point where they're not intimidated by belief anymore at all. And then, you know, the whole universe is overlaid, and then at some point it doesn't even need to arise anymore at all. That becomes, that moment gets closer by your watching this, gets a lot closer for the entire universe, actually. No exceptions. Brings the entire universe closer to its own non-arising, which means you choose a new idea, and it doesn't arise. Ultimately, we choose the idea of the overlay, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. The universe remains; it's just overlaid. Okay, it's overlaid; it's still there. But then, eventually, we'll choose a new idea that's not even the idea of not wanting to change reality. It's just an idea that's not even related to the whole idea of change or not change. And then the universe doesn't even arise at all. And what you have is reality, essence, seamlessness, and invulnerable endlessness, expansiveness, that which cannot be changed or threatened in any way. You know, it's beyond what we can talk about or even imagine. So save time for the whole universe. You're doing great work. You may think nobody's listening to this or paying attention or doesn't matter. It's not true. Absolutely not true. Every little bit of intimidation you can overcome from belief, you're actually saving the entire universe some time, whether anyone knows about it or not, which is why Ramana coming to me of his own volition in that vision when I was sleeping, he said, you may not recognize this or know it. He said, I said, look, Ramana, I didn't know who it was. I just said, look, I see all these people are following you and worshiping you and telling you how great you are. Not worshiping, I'm saying you're great, you're the greatest. I want to teach the way you teach. And this being said to me, it was Ramana, so we'll say it was Ramana Maharshi. He said, yes, I understand that. I have a ton of people following me. I have a whole vast throng of people following what I'm, you know, they look up to me and following in my footsteps. He said, yes, that's true. And I said, I've been looking at what you're doing. I say, it's great. No problem. I had no problem. I said, yeah, it's great. You know, I'm happy that there's all these people who are following you. And then he said, yeah. But I've been watching you, what you're doing, and there's nobody paying attention to what you're doing. I said, yeah, that's true. And he said, okay, and you're upset about it. I said, yeah, it's kind of unnerving. He said, don't worry about it. I've been paying attention to it. And he said, you know, what you're doing is going to save so much time for the entire universe. He said, you can't see it. And I said, that's right, I don't think I'm having any effect at all. He says, you can't see it, but I can see it. And so you just take my word for it. I'm seeing it. And it's going to be incredibly helpful for the entire universe. It's going to, you know, cut off in a massive amount of delay, you know, make it unnecessary and bring that moment when you know, no one is, there's no intimidation anymore from belief at all. It's bringing it, you know, much, much closer. And Ramana said, you don't recognize it. You don't see it because you don't see it yet. And so you're all bummed out. And you're feeling like quitting and giving up, and it's not worth anything. He said, no, don't do that, because I can see it. I can see it very clearly. I said, really? You've been watching? He says, absolutely, I've been watching what you're doing. And he says, it's fabulous. He said, it's really, really good. And just stick with it. And eventually, you know, you'll recognize that it's actually been helping the entire universe. It's just you don't have that perspective yet. And I said, wow. And the guy was so sincere, you know, Ramana was so sincere. It was pure sincerity, you know, I'm telling you. Phew, amazing, absolutely amazing. I can understand why those who met him were just blown away by him. I never saw him in the flesh here in this world, but in that dream, it was literally him in his subtle body. And I was blown away by his sincerity and his trustworthiness, you know. I believed him, totally. I mean, I accepted his advice. Stick with it, because I could tell this was pure sincerity and pure kindness and pure intelligence, and he wasn't lying, you know, he was telling me the truth. And so I said, yeah, okay, I accept it from you. So, you know, I've been through this situation where you feel like what you're doing is not helping anybody, really. Maybe helping yourself a little bit, but not reaching anybody else in the world. And it's true, you're reaching the entire universe. But it's real hard for us to see that. You know, if you can't see it, we have to go on faith. We really have to go on faith, this is true. But Ramana told me, he said, look, you got to go on faith, but I can, for absolute certainty, And so I said, okay, I'll have faith in, you know, in your certainty. Because he was worth, you know, he was worthy of having faith in his certainty. He was worthy of it. Because I couldn't see single flaw in his character at all. Flawless character, completely flawless character. I was just like, afterwards, I was like just stunned. You know, I said, oh my gosh, this is a flawless character. No flaw whatsoever. So I said, I'll trust him. I'll trust what he has to say and keep working on it. I wouldn't be here today if it weren't for that meeting. That is for sure. That is for sure. No way. I would have, you know, who knows what would have happened. I wouldn't be here. That is for sure. Because it takes that faith and some certainty. You need help. Because even if you're help, you know, making progress, you think, well, what's the use? Nobody's paying any attention. And now there's, you know, there's some that are paying attention and they're saying they're getting help, you know, which is a great thing for me because at least I feel this is doing some good. But what we don't see is the big picture, the totality of the situation. And I'm telling you for sure that you're paying attention to this and even considering it. And the main thing is you recognize I'm not bullied by belief so much. And you see that, you hear that, and you say, ah, it's possible. And by saying it's possible, you're sending that vibe out to the entire universe that it's possible. You say, yeah, you know, it's doable. I can see it. I can feel it to some extent. Now, you come across someone like Ramana or Jesus or Nanmaima, and I've come across all three of those, and for them, it's certainty. And their vibe to the whole universe is profound. You know, you get this certainty radiating out. And has a profound effect. Saves an incredible amount of time. But our certainty is not the same perfect certainty. But it still, you know, can be strong enough to have a profound effect on the entire universe. Not to the same extent, but still profound effect on the entire universe. All of time, the entire situation is saving it time. Saving vast amounts of time. Because he's saying, haha, I know that we can stand up to that bully of belief. It, absolutely, we will do it. And that sends that assurance is sent throughout the entire universe instantaneously. Instantaneously. Doesn't take any time for thought to travel, okay? It's at the deepest level, this assurance, it's omnipresent. It's omnipresent. You know, and we can't understand how that's possible. But we can think ourselves, you know, at the far end edge of the universe, right? We can think ourselves, you know, right now, we can do that. It doesn't take any time or space for us to thought, from the standpoint of thought, to do that. So you are doing something of total value by at least catching the vibe of this assurance. You are then amplifying that vibe of assurance, and that saves a massive amount of time for the entire universe and everything that, you know, is engaged with this scenario of belief. Because they say, ah, I can stand up to this scenario of belief too. Like, I can feel it. I think, you know, I feel I can do it. Yes, I can. I can do this. And then they, you know, start doing it. Bit by bit by bit, they start, you know, standing up to belief. And as belief, of course, belief will try to intimidate them, try to mock them, and they will gradually stand up to that and get better and better and better and better. Then I'm testifying that's exactly what I've done. Bit by bit by bit, stand up to it. And, you know, still have some ways to go. I don't know how much. You know, I really don't know how much. I'm not going to speculate on how much. Certainly have done a lot, enough to, you know, say the stuff I've said. And I'm sure belief isn't the slightest bit happy about any of that. It's not amused for sure. Like again, two nights ago, I really had a real intense showdown with belief. And, you know, came out on top of that, you know, and didn't back down. So, you can do it. You absolutely can do it. And you actually will do it at some point. And, you know, why not now? Why waste time? Why waste time? Just keep on catching that vibe of assurance, which is wherever you can find it. You don't have to find it here. You can find it wherever you find it. It's fine with me, because it all comes back to me, too. Wherever you find assurance and wherever you are able to stand up to the bully of belief, that is shared with the whole sonship. Everyone. Shared with everyone. So I get it. Wherever you get it from, it's shared with me already. So it doesn't matter to me what teacher you go to. It doesn't make any difference to me at all. Because wherever you get that assurance, I'm going to benefit from that. And wherever I get the assurance from, you're going to benefit from that. So, you know, I'm just saying, you know, go for it. Wherever you can find it. Whatever teacher, you know, can give you the 100% or gives you that, you know, true assurance, or gives you a lot of assurance if you don't want 100% or, but that one that is aware, that is in line with 100%, you know, who that's their goal. Like in my instance, that's my goal. So in other words, I'm not accepting any compromise position. I'm not 100% yet, but I'm putting it in the context of 100%. So that's important. Otherwise, you'll get into a faux spirituality, which is not giving the kind of assurance that is necessary. But wherever you can get that which is in alignment with 100%, 100%ers, that certainty, get it from them. Get it where, you know, doesn't matter that what their name is, what their nationality, what their race is, what their age is, what their gender is, makes no difference to me whatsoever, none. Because whatever little bit of standing up to the bully of belief you get when you do, that's shared with everyone. Whatever attitude you have, yes, I can do this, I am doing it, that's shared with everyone. So it's great. It's great. I may have to exit at some point here. Get dinner. I guess maybe people are getting hungry. Probably are. They're probably getting hungry. So again, it's great fun to do this video. And it's been well worth my time. I hope it's worth your time. Stay with the truth, and the truth will stay with you. Absolutely. Okay, that's it for this video.